Bibles to Colossians chapter 3. I'm going to be reading from verse 18 through verse 4, or actually chapter 4, verse 1, as we continue to look at what Paul is teaching the Christians in Colossae. Now, this is one of those Sunday mornings when the preacher gets a little worried because it is going to deal with one of those passages which says that women should submit to their husbands. So the complaint office of the church is closed from 10 to 12 till next year. But there's a more serious matter here. And that's sort of what I prayed about. God has established an authority structure in this world. And yet, it seems that people are rebelling against any type of established authority. The problem we have in America today, we can think of race, we can think of a number of issues, but at heart, we're seeing a breakdown of the family, and it is having consequences all across America. Because people are rebelling against the way God set things up. And let's look at what Paul says about our relationships, not only in the family, but with our children and at work. Hear God's word. Wives, submit to your husband as is fitting in the Lord. Husbands, love your wives and do not be harsh with them. Children, obey your parents in everything, for this pleases the Lord. Fathers, do not provoke your children, lest they become discouraged. Slaves, obey in everything those who are your earthly masters, not by way of eye service as people pleasers, but with sincerity of heart, fearing the Lord. Whatever you do, work heartily as for the Lord and not for men, knowing that from the Lord you will receive the inheritance as your reward. You are serving the Lord Christ. For the wrongdoer will be paid back for the wrong he has done, and there is no partiality. Masters, treat your slaves justly and fairly, knowing that you also have a master in heaven. Let's pray and ask God's blessing on his word. Jesus, these words come from you, ultimately. And there's parts of here that may offend everyone, and they should, because we don't think your thoughts after you. But help us this morning to submit to your word, and to submit to the structures that you have given to us. Hear our prayer. In Christianity, where does the rubber meet the road, as we say? How do we know that all of this talk about grace is true? How do we know that we are filled with the Spirit? How do we know that all that time that we've spent in Sunday school and church and vacation Bible school is valid? Well, part of the test of truth is the inerrancy of Scripture, that God has given us a book without error. But there's something else. It's how we live our life in this world is also a mark of the truth of Scripture. And that means that we are to be obedient. In the book of Romans, which talks about justification by faith, which talks a lot about grace, it begins and ends with this phrase, the faith of obedience. The faith which we have received by grace is meant to change our lives. Christianity should not be overly intellectual. There is more to it than a feel-good worship service. It means but with our whole being, we're willing to follow God to become more like Him in our thoughts, our emotions, and our actions. And in the context here, in chapter 3, verse 1, it says, if you have been raised with Christ, Seek the things that are above where Christ is. He is referring to the holiness of Jesus. And that holiness will be borne out in the relations which we have with one another. So if you want to know if you truly believe that all of this is true, you're going to have to look at your lives in relationship to one another and in the structures of society. And here's the first relationship. Husbands and wives. Marriage. Now, I got to tell you, marriages are in trouble. All over the place. The divorce rate is up. Domestic violence is up. One out of three women, supposedly, this was some time ago, but it may have changed. One out of three women seek emergency treatment at the emergency room or the doctor's office. 50% of female murders, the victims, was done by a boyfriend or a husband. There is spousal abuse, which comes from boyfriends and husbands. So I'm not going to say that women are not suffering. They are suffering, and this can even take place in the Christian home. Yes, there can be abuse, and there can be damage not only to the soul, but to the body. And we may be thinking to ourselves, why can't we all get along? Well, it's because of sin. And sin can take place in marriages. And we make all sorts of jokes about it. For example, there are the two little girls. One doesn't know the story of Cinderella, and the other one does. And one tells the other about how Cinderella had all the ugly sisters or stepsisters, and in the end, she became a princess and was changed and all that. And one little girl said, well, did they live happily ever after, Cinderella and the prince? And the other girl says, no, they got married. Yeah. The other story that comes to my mind when you think of marriages comes from Chuck Swindoll. A wife asks a husband this question: if I die, will you get remarried? The husband says, well, I really haven't thought about it that much, but yeah, I guess I will. The wife says, well, will you have your new wife come into this house? I don't know, says the husband. Yeah, probably. Well, will she sleep in the same bed? I guess so. And the wife says, well, will she use my golf clubs? And the husband says, no, she's a left-hander. Oh, there's so many problems in marriage. But for a strong, biblical marriage, Scripture says that wives are to be submissive to their husbands. Now, this is unpopular. 64% at one time in America said they didn't believe that. And when they found out from the Bible, it was only a little bit lower. I think I read a survey somewhere that even Southern Baptist women don't like this passage. And to be quite honest, I think if I was a woman, I probably wouldn't like it either. It's difficult, but it nevertheless is in the Bible, and we have to take it seriously. Now, keep in mind this, ladies, if you don't like it. Jesus also submitted. He submitted to the will of the Heavenly Father. He submitted to death. Do you realize in Scripture it tells us that all Christians are to submit in one form or another? For example, in Hebrews 12, verse 9, it says this: besides this, we have had earthly fathers who disciplined us and we respect them. Shall we not much more be subject to the Father of spirits and live? In other words, to affirm to God. In Ephesians chapter 5, it tells us what it means to be filled with the Spirit. And it says a number of things. It says that you should be giving thanks. It says that you should be singing hymns and spiritual songs. And then it tells us that you are to submit to one another. See that word submission? Now, ladies, I know this is directed at you, but it's also for a number of people in the church. And it deals with Jesus even. Everybody's submitting in one form or another. And here's what it means. It means that you have to yield at times. And it means you have to respect an imperfect husband. And this is where it gets tough. Because we are imperfect. And that idea of yielding in a marriage, it just doesn't go along with our modern day values. Now it doesn't. Now let me be clear, I'm not saying that you yield to sin. If your husband says, let's go out and rob a bank together, the answer is no. If your husband is physically abusive, the marriage covenant is already broken, get out. But in the general order of things, there's got to be a bottom line. And husbands, yes, we care. But there is this aspect of yielding to your husband and showing him respect. And we often think of men disrespecting the women folk. Let me tell you, it can go the other way too. Women can be disrespectful to their husbands. Women can even beat up their husbands. And we need to be aware of that as a church. But the biblical view is one of respect and yielding to your husband. Now, and ladies, I know you're waiting for this. Let's get to the other side of the story. One time, Jan and I were in Waffle House, that wonderful restaurant where I like to do a lot of business. We walk in, and there was a young man arguing with the waitress over this very issue. You women all have to submit to men. And I was getting irritated because it was getting loud, but I also went up and was wanting to say to him, did you read the rest of the verse? It says you're to lay down your life for your wife. Are you willing to do that? Are you willing to love her as Christ loved the church? This is the other side of the story here. For husbands, you think submission is tough? Loving to the point where it hurts and you may have to lay down your life is also pretty hard too. And it goes against what we want to do. Successful husband is not one who controls. It's what verse 19 says. You're to love your wives with that self-sacrificial love, and you're not to be harsh with them. It's the same thing in Ephesians chapter 5. Now, guys, let's be honest. When you're out in the yard and you're doing work and your wife comes out to try to help you and, you know, she sprays you with the hose, which was an accident or something. Okay? That's not the way you'd act. Not be that way. If you come home and things aren't perfect, what does Scripture say? You're not to be harsh. But there's this tendency for men, because we got bad tempers, it's to be harsh. It is to be controlling all the time. And that is not how the marital relationship should be. Husbands, your role is to sacrifice for your wife. And that may mean saying, you're wrong. We are going to do it this way this time, which is your way here. You are to build up your wife. Not tear her down. Once there was a young man. His mom had been married before. The husband died, and this mom was big and strong. She never encouraged this young man. And as he grew up, one of the school counselors said, this kid doesn't even know what love is. And it's because he came from a terrible environment where he was never encouraged, never taken care of. Later on, he went and joined the Marines. Why? So he could become a man. But he was rejected by his fellow Marines. He went to a foreign country, and they rejected him. He met a girl over there that came back to America, and guess what she did? She had no respect for him either. They had children. And one day he felt sorry, so he said, here's
$75, you can do what you want. She laughed, she made fun of him. And he was all alone. And then one day he did the only thing he knew he could do well. He got his rifle, he went out and shot John F. Kennedy. His name? Oswald. You see how the marital relationship and the family relationship destroyed life. As Christians, we're not to do that. And let me tell you something else. If you are thinking about getting married, if you're not willing to submit, and you are looking for a man, and he's not willing to love you, and he is not willing to respect you, and he is not willing to lay down his life for you, and he's got a bad temper, don't get married. Because I got to tell you, it's better being single and not having to deal with that. Don't do it. It'll end in disaster. So that's how we're to live in our relationship to one another. Submission on the one hand and love. In fact, they're both a type of submission. But let's go on here, because there's another relationship, and that has to do with parents and children. You see it here in verse 20. Children, obey your parents in everything that this pleases the Lord. Fathers, do not provoke your children, lest they become discouraged. Now, the old view was, children, you're to be obedient. Well, that's the way it is when I grew up. Children are to be seen, not heard. Not the way it is anymore. Children have their rights. By the way, parents don't go in the bedrooms anymore to see what's on the computer, what's on their cell phone. No, they have rights. We've got to protect them. They can make their own decisions. Now, I got to tell you, there is a sense where kids need more to make their own decisions. But what this is breeding, I really think, is a form of anti-authoritarianism. But here it says, children, you're to be obedient. In Ephesians chapter 6, verse 2, here's what it says. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and your mother. This is the first commandment with a promise. Why does he say it's the first commandment? It is not first in the list of the Ten Commandments. It's the first commandment because it's the most important to them. Children are to be obedient. Obedient children. This is what is pleasing to God. And if you want to know if the gospel is taking hold of your child's heart, you've got to look for two things. They can make a credible profession of faith, but also, how's that obedience going? Are they the type of children who will go to school, listen to teachers, not get in trouble? Are they the type who will clean up when you ask them to, or are they constantly fighting against it? The outward sign of their belief is obedience in the Lord. And let me tell you now, this is why some kids don't get it. And I've seen this in the school system. Because their parents are always rebelling against everything. You know, there's certain school rules. Kid gets in trouble. Just this week, parent comes in. Well, that's not right. The rules. These kids are learning and disobeying because their parents are. And parent, that puts a burden on you. You also in your life must be obedient because that's who they're learning it from. But here's the other side of the coin. Look at what it says about fathers. Fathers, don't provoke your children or don't exasperate them. Is it possible for fathers to be overly demanding? Wasn't the Roman Empire. It can still be that way today, where you provoke your kids so much by either petty rules or cutting them down that they are going to rebel. You're destroying the life of a child if you're that way. And I hear the stories all the time from the school system of how a father or a mother hit a child. Not just spanking. I'm talking fists. Yes, there's a place for discipline. There's a place for corporal punishment. I'm not suggesting that we should be against that. But this is a heated fight with children. Shouldn't be that way. Shouldn't be that way
Yes, you should punish your children, but it should never be in anger. Give yourself time to cool down before you punish your child. And also, here's what you've got to do. You want to know what to pray for your children for? That's what I pray for my grandchildren. That they will be not only converted, but they'll be obedient, sure. And they will be protected, sure. That's what we have to aim for. Because we only have those kids for a short time. They're really on loan from God. That's the relationship we're to have in our families and our children. And there's one more here. It is the relationship between employees and employers. Now, here's the problem. Look at this verse. What is the deal with? Slavery. Slavery. We don't have slavery today. Roman world, they had slavery. Some estimate that half of the Roman population were slaves. 60 million people in the Roman Empire, we don't have that today. Well, how do we apply this? It deals with work, because all work is service to one another. I like what Dorothy Sayers says, a Christian from a different century. The church is uncommonly interested in the bedroom, and so singularly silent about the boardroom. We have missed out at times in the church of applying Christian principles to the place of work. And here's what it says. Instead of thinking of slaves here, think of employees. It says we're to be obedient to our bosses. That we are to work not just to catch the attention of people, but to actually do a job with the Lord. In 1 Corinthians 4:2, it says we're to be good and faithful stewards. One of my favorite movies is Chariots of Fire. And in the movie Chariots of Fire, Eric Liddell, the great runner, is with his father and his sister. And his sister says to Eric Liddell, "Oh, missionary work is more important." And Eric's father says, "You can peel a potato for the glory of God as well as doing other things." Our work is a way to glorify God. And what you have to do as a worker is to do your best and to be able to work with the Lord in mind. That's who you're ultimately serving. You've got to do a good job. You've got to be there on time. You can't waste time. Now, I know there are some jobs where there's not a lot going on. I remember growing up that I worked at Howard Johnson's and at the night shift, and believe me, there was nothing going on. And so what did I do? Well, I did read a book and talk to somebody. I don't think that's wasting the company's time. But still, we've got to be aware that you can waste time when you should be working. We're to be stewards of God. That's your job if you have a job. And let's talk about the other half of this. Those who are employees, you've got to do what is just and fair. Employees are not machines. Now, that was a great problem in a previous century when the factory system started out. The new worker was to be just one of the machines. It's not the way it should be. They have to be paid. They have to be taken care of too. They have to be developed. They're human beings. They can't work 16 hours a day. Or, I hear this a lot of time, "Well, we need you to work more. We're not going to pay you anymore, but we want you to work more." Now, there are times when the job season just picks up. You're going to have to work more. In the school contracts, they have what's known as other duties. That means they got to go back to school at like 6 o'clock and spend till 9 o'clock there. That's just the way it is. However, as bosses, we've got to be careful that we don't mistreat our employees and become unjust by not paying them and not rewarding them for their labor. We don't treat them as machines. Number
Scrooge was he? He didn't pay his workers. He mistreated them. We don't want to be the Scrooges of the world. We want our workplace and our work relationships to reflect Christ. So how does the rubber meet the road? It meets it in those relationships that we have in life, whether it's family or work. I often recall the remark of Martin Luther, the German reformer. He said, "You want to learn about holiness? Don't go to a monastery. Get married." And I would also say, go to work. You'll learn more about holiness and being in those situations and what it means to be a Christian than just by total withdrawal from the world and staying out by yourself. And underlying all this is our ability to submit to one another. That's how the rubber meets the road. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we come before you now, admitting our mistakes, our failures in our families and at work. But Lord Jesus, we ask that you will show us your grace, that we'll realize